AM to the PM, PM to the AM foam. Piss out your per diem, you just gotta hate them foam. If I quit your BM, I still rock Mercedes foam. If I quit this season, I still be the greatest funk.
My left stroke just went viral.
Right stroke, put a baby in a spiral. Soprano C, we like to keep it on the high.
Welcome to another episode of Coach's Corner. This is episode number 50. Today we have a special guest, Riley Presnell. Welcome to the show for the second time.
Hi. Yeah, no, actually I think it's the third time, right? Because well, I did this is the one Coach's Corner, Coach's one Corner. Be on the platform.
Yeah, we don't talk about the other one. Trevor gets upset because he was never included. Although I do have somebody coming on tomorrow for an interview because I felt like when you cheated on this podcast with Riley, I felt like I should bring it back. Just, you know, it's kind of like vengeance more so than anything.
I would just like to point out that I always supported and shared the Beyond the Platform interviews. It's not my fault that many of the powerlifters you chose to interview have difficulties putting sentences together that sound amusing or entertaining.
Pretty much what I'm hearing is like really healthy communication right now. Like, you know, like Trevor cheats on your podcast, so you get revenge. Like, right. This is really healthy. I support this.
I'm so antisocial. I can't help it.
Yes. Facebook, that is where you air out all of your issues.
Yeah. Yeah. But I figured, you know, let's just do it on air live so he can't back out of it.
So we're going to advertise it now. Who do you got coming on for an interview?
Christopher Bearcat.
Okay, so the pressure's on, Mr. Bearcat, to be entertaining and enthusiastic and educational at the same time, because it's not as easy as it sounds.
Yeah, he has.
Well, I mean, if he doesn't do well, that means that, and if he doesn't do well, then you might not have any more interview podcasts. So it would be up to him on whether or not Beyond the. So basically, Beyond the Platform is on his shoulders.
Right, 100%.
Some of the previous guests set the bar so low, I think he'll be fine. So we'll be good. Although, I've noticed the audience doesn't tend to like the science people. He does. He's a educator at the University of Tampa, just wrote a systematic review on body composition. So that's kind of why I want to have him on. And he's also doing a case study with Terrence Ruffin, who is an Olympian classic physique guy. So he's doing a case study where he's tracking him and all his blood work from the beginning of prep for the Olympia to the end of prep. So that's like one of the first elite bodybuilders that are going to be tested. So I think it'd be cool to have them on. But like I said, people don't enjoy the sciencey people for some reason.
People want to learn, but then when they feel like they're slightly challenged or like maybe they don't quite understand it right away, they're like, this is too hard.
It's true.
So I freely admit that I'm a slow learner and I have to this is where the habit of repeating things three times come from, because for me to absorb something, I have to watch it or read it or do it three times to really learn it. Mm-hmm. So I'm just a really slow learner. I'm a really slow reader, as fast as I'm a talker, which is crazy. So I tend to listening to a podcast like that, which has information, a third of it's probably going to go over my head. So I'll listen to it again and again until I've absorbed all of it. So people who choose to avoid the sciencey ones because they're a little bit technical should probably just listen to it like 2 and 3 times, which helps Tony out, because then he's like, all of a sudden this one got listened to 3,000 times instead of 1,000. So you're welcome again for that.
Or you can just listen to a podcast and take notes as well. But I think it does make sense, right? Like as fast as you talk probably means that you have a lot to say. Yeah. And if you have a lot to say while you're trying to read or learn, that's probably running through your head. So you're not going to be able to absorb anything because you don't have a clear head while you're reading. So you're kind of probably thinking about shit in the back of your mind while you're trying to read. And then you read like 10 pages, like, I have no fucking clue what I just read.
It does. It's exactly what happens. I get like sparked with creativity or inspiration. And of course, I never write anything down. So I'll read something like upstairs while I'm going to the bathroom and then come down like, Riley, you're going to think I'm crazy. But you know, I still write it down.
Yeah, that happens all the time. Trevor does read pretty slow. He always gets mad because like, if we both start a book at the same time, I will finish it in like a third of the time that he takes to finish it.
She's being polite. She'll finish it like 5 times the speed.
And like I speed read a little bit more because I do find that if I read something slower to try to digest it a little bit better, I do have it like more thoughts come in and it stops me from actually comprehending what I'm reading rather than just absorbing it. So like when we've watched a couple like speed reading videos on like how to, because Trevor wants to know how, so that way he doesn't feel so defeated with reading. But that's what they tell you, is that you need to, instead of trying to absorb every word, that you just need to pick out the main words. Like they tell you to take out like the uhs, the a's, the thes, like all those words, and just kind of absorb the main larger words, and your brain will automatically put the sentence together for you. Yeah. And then it's more of imagery. So that way you remember what you're reading rather than trying to like read every single word super slow and digest it.
Right. And that's, I mean, that's the same thing with sign language, right? They take out all the little prepositions and all that other stuff. And it's just like the meat and potatoes of the words. And I've also done some research on memorization, and a lot of people that are really good with memorization do the same thing, where it's just like they're putting words with certain caricatures, so that brings the memory back a lot better than just trying to memorize the words. Because we just had to do a exam on glycolysis and the Krebs cycle and all that stuff. We had to memorize all the enzymes and all that, and it was much easier to give it like a I think it's an acronym, right, where you put all the letters and you make a word out of it. I'm sure there's other things that go with that, but that's what I did. I just took all those things and made it an acronym, something that I can easily remember. And that's always helped me. There's when I was in college at Florida University, I was taking an art class, which is the easiest class in the world. Anybody that has an art degree, it's not a real degree. Sorry. To break your heart. That's like a clown degree. It's so easy. But the teacher sang a song about Constantinople. And I was like, man, this is stupid. I still have that song stuck in my head 10 years later about Constantinople and everything that he did. And it was like, this is amazing. I feel like that's always the best way to learn, but you don't really think of it, you know, until it's kind of like too late to memorize stuff.
Yeah. That's another thing too, is like, I've watched, there was like a show on Netflix, I think it was called 100 Humans, and they go through different tests. And one of them was like memory. And they said the most effective way to remember things like that is songs, or if you create a sentence, like if you're supposed to remember like purple cow jump, like those are the three things you're supposed to remember. If you make it a sentence, like I watched the purple cow jump over the hay, you know, like they say that makes it easier to remember other than just trying to remember arbitrary words that don't mean anything to you.
Yeah. And now too, whenever I read, I'll write a book report based on what I just read, and that kind of refreshes everything and ingrains it a little bit more in my head. And then it's in obviously a Word document, so I can always go back, and it's like the Cliff Notes version of the book that I was reading. It makes it a lot easier, because I used to have the same issue, man. I would read a book and I'm like, fuck, I don't even remember anything that I just read. I spent like 3 weeks reading this book. It's like 200 pages. I have no fucking clue what I just read. And it's like, I got to do something better. And I can't be the person that's like, I've read over 1,000 books. Like, what do you remember? I'm like, I don't know.
I will forget things, and then something else will trigger it. That memory will pop up from something else. And the training aspect and coaching aspect is almost the same way. Because something will come along and trigger a memory or a corrective exercise or a movement or a cue that you've forgotten about that you may have used 100 times over, but it's not in the front of your brain. It's in the back of your brain. It's in that little filing cabinet that takes place there. And then something triggers that memory. You see something or you hear something and you're like, oh, this will apply to that person or this will help that person. So when you hear that expression, like that person's forgotten more about training than I'll ever learn. Yeah. That is so true.
For sure. For sure. Yeah, I was listening to a podcast with Cal Dietz on it. And Cal Dietz is someone that, even if you're just a strength coach that deals with powerlifters, you should know Cal Dietz is. He wrote Triphasic Training. And he was on this, and it's like you just said, man, there was things that he would talk about that he'd be able to regurgitate from the old super training emails. Like, remember Mel Siff used to do super training emails? And it was like, he just remembered all that stuff. And there's people that are like that, though. There are people that have those good memories. Dr. Scott Stevenson's another one where you can talk to him about any subject, it seems like, and he can just regurgitate like a study he has memorized, where it's like me, I have notes. If I have to talk about something, I have notes. Cause there's no, I mean, I don't know that I'm sure there's, you figure it out, right? Like once you get your PhD and, you know, you study forever, you find ways to make things sit in your mind. But man, some of those guys are just amazing that they can just recall that stuff over and over from 20 years ago. It would be awesome to have a neuroscience on. I did reach out to Andrew Huberman. Likelihood of him actually messaging me back, slim to none. But if anybody knows him, tell him that I messaged him and I'd like to have him on the podcast to talk some neuroscience stuff.
Oh, I've seen his videos on YouTube going around and the nootropics and stuff like that and interesting stuff from him. He lifts too. So that's kind of in our wheelhouse. That's pretty good. That would be a good one to have on.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he's the head neuroscience at Stanford. He has his own lab and he does a bunch of really cool stuff. And I've been listening to his podcast. I'm like, oh man, it'd be great to have him on. But you know how that goes. I reached out to him, probably won't ever see it.
You're not big enough yet.
Yeah, you got cool guy.
Yeah.
It's all right. Fair enough. All right, so we have some questions that we need to get to. Obviously, we have Riley on today for the 50th episode, and feel like it's always good to get a different perspective, even though you've probably toxicked her mind in a state where it's like...
She's an independent thinker.
Yeah. I'm sure you put stuff in her water and just trying to,
I can't even get her to drink the water, which is why replenish is so important for her.
I was going
to
say, the only
terrible at hydration.
The only thing that goes in my water is replenish. Yes. Anymore, so.
It is good. It is. But yeah, I feel like it's always good to have a different set of eyes, a different coach on, especially one with your background with the psychology degree and stuff like that. And just dealing with a little bit more of the intrinsic nuances of communication and some of the emotions that people go through. So it's always good to have, I think, that perspective on things, where me and Trevor, although we do love communication and psychology end of things, we're not as inundated as, I guess I would say, as you are. So it's nice to have that for sure.
Yeah. So you guys are like old and crotchety, is what you're saying.
Well, I was about to say, the closest I come to my psychology review is just how crazy I am.
I read psychology books.
Yeah, I think the psychology that Trevor gets is through whatever I say, or true. Like when he'll say something and then I ask him a question that has to inspire some thought behind it. And he's like, damn it, why are you making me think about things?
My psychology background is really more like influence, persuasion, neuro-linguistic programming, things of that nature, from marketing books and whatnot. It's not really deep thought psychology of understanding human emotion. It's just creating emotion.
Do you do any like experiments on him that you've learned?
We're not going to talk about the bedroom in here. I'm trying to keep it PG.
If I do, it's unknowingly, I guess. Oh, okay. I feel like I generally kind of do that with social media things. Like I find myself wanting to post things or change things or like tweak things to see if other people follow those things or see how other people perceive those things. I don't necessarily have any that I would want to like air out that I've done, but I've definitely done some things on social media where I'm like, I wonder how influential changing certain things or talking about certain things or even posting a certain way or, you know, small things like fonts and like all those kind of things. I find myself doing those unknowingly, like, oh, I wonder what would happen if I did this. And then I just kind of watch how it plays out. I don't know that I've ever actually knowingly done any to Trevor.
You don't want to be up in this. There's no escaping this.
I didn't mean like getting inside your head. Like you said, that's dangerous ground. But I meant like manipulating you. Was it Skinner that had the dogs, or was it Pavlov?
It was Pavlov.
Yeah. You know, do an experiment like that where he just starts salivating whenever he hears like a bell or something.
Well, we're so like routine anyways that I do notice that when I go to reheat like our rice or I put something in the microwave, and when the microwave timer goes off, I hear him like sit up from his chair because he knows that it's time to eat.
So you do that. You just start having a timer go off, and every time he'll sit up without the food.
That's why I salivate whenever the rice is done in the rice cooker.
Like pretty much any time that like a kitchen noise dings, I hear him like move because he's like, oh, okay, food's ready. So like but that's just mostly because I think we're so like regimented, I guess.
Yeah, she threw a man's heart through his stomach. Yeah. That's her level of flirting. I'm like, hey, you look pretty today. And she's like, ding. I'm like, oh yeah.
Oh, it's so good. All right, Trevor, you have most of the questions today, so go ahead and start us off.
I got a really good one from Chuck Anderson that I really wanted to go over. And it says, and I really wanted to go over because we have three different perspectives. You know, I'm old. Tony is emotionally old. And Riley is newer, so not so old. But it's like, everyone experiences this. Every single lifter has experienced this in some capacity. So I really wanted to go over this. And he says, post-meet blues, how do you help your clients with them? And I thought that was a really great question, because at any point in your competitive career or sports career or whatever you're doing, you're going to experience that, the high of the meet, the peaking phase of the meet, and then the coming down from it. And like, what do you do? And I know that you have gone from like bodybuilding shows after meets, or, you know, you've given yourself a different direction. And most newer level powerlifters usually go from meet to meet to meet to meet to meet too fast. They do too many meets because they're always looking for that next thing and a reason to train. And Riley's a little bit newer, and she just spent a long time between meets, you know, with this training. So there is that lull where you feel like you don't have something to train for, and people get emotionally down. Some of that is hormonal as well. If you're an untested athlete, you're using things. So there is some little bit of a hormonal drop off. But I think that was really, really good to talk about, because I think the most important aspect of that is finding something within training that interests you. And that's where people make the mistake, is they come off of a meet, and if they don't communicate to their coach what they're going through or let them know, so the coach can then make it more interesting, the coach is automatically go, okay, here's what I noticed in your meet. Here's what we need to work on. Let's go right to work on these things. You know, let's build up some quad size. Let's build up some upper back size, whatever. And you're right back to the barbell after a week deload or whatever. And you're back into the same routine and mundaneness of preparing for meet. Whereas we get in this dogma of, I have to squat, bench, and deadlift to be better at squat, benching, and deadlift. And that is true in the long term. You're going to have to squat, bench, and deadlift. But it doesn't mean you can't take the next 4 weeks to have fun and do like 3 days of squat, bench, deadlift work at a maintenance level, and do like 2 weightlifting classes, 2 CrossFit classes, pick up basketball, or just spend 4 to 6 weeks focusing on a machine and dumbbell bodybuilding workout so your joints and your brain are at a break, and maybe doing something. I know you like to do a lot of body recomp post meet and have people come down and rebuild their carbohydrate tolerance. I think the most important aspect is first communicating to your coach and saying, hey, I know I have this. I experienced this. This sounds fun to me. Can we do this? And the coach is likely going to work it in if he actually cares. So that's the first thing, is identifying a desire that you want to train for. If you don't have a desire to want to train, you're not going to want to train, clearly. And if you're just doing the same mundane routine thing, it's not going to help you very much. You're going to go through that post-meet blues. So the first thing is identify what you want to do in the gym. And that's what your first priority should be in the gym after that. Whatever it is you want to do. If you want to put on size, put on size. If you want to cut down, cut down. If you want to take up running for a little while. I have a guy I started working with a few weeks ago, from his last meet. He decided he wanted to train for a freaking marathon. So he went from powerlifting to marathon training and back to powerlifting. He's getting ready for the power surge meet, and his strength is coming back so freaking fast because he's really enthusiastic about training for this meet, because he wasn't going from meet to meet to meet. He took a long time off and did something so polar opposite. He gave himself a different and unique challenge, which reinvigorated him when he got back to powerlifting training. And I think that's the most important aspect people miss, is they just go right back to the routine, and you don't need to do that.
Yeah. You want to go ahead?
Well, I was just going to say, when you said pick up basketball game, like my hamstring cramped up. I was like, that's not going to be a good thing at all.
You're so old.
It's not that I'm old. I'm just not athletic anymore. Those days are long gone.
Wait. When were you athletic?
Okay. First off, I was all state high school, pal. So that's when I was athletic. I did play rugby in college too.
Kids in the same town. We're all Allstate High School. Anyone who got first ring was Allstate High School.
I played rugby in college, and then it kind of went downhill from there.
I was on the chess team, I'll have you know.
Go ahead, Riley.
I feel like this kind of depends on the lifter. I feel like, if I look at my lifters right now, I feel like it's pretty evenly split to where 50% of the people are very, very goal driven and like goal specific to where that meet is like all that they can think of. And the other 50% really just kind of enjoy the process, and like the meet just kind of comes along with it. So I feel like their post meets look a little bit different. I know some people will compete and they kind of just like compete because, you know, you like, obviously we don't have to, but you kind of do, because that's part of it. Like that is part of training. Like you train to compete and whatnot, and like they'll train, but they'll be most excited about the off season. And I feel like that's kind of how I am, is I actually really enjoy the off season. Competing is fun and I like to see what I can do, but like, I'm already ready for whatever's going to happen post meet. So I feel like differentiating those two types of lifters is important, that for the goal specific lifter, who is like, okay, well, I just did this meet, now when's my next meet? Those ones you have to have a little bit more finesse with, I feel. Those ones you have to give a goal. So for those lifters, maybe if they're a conventional puller and they mentioned they wanted to try sumo, I will give them the challenge of trying sumo because they have to learn a fully new stance. You know,
I like how you phrase it as the challenge of trying sumo. Yeah, well,
that's exactly what it is.
It's the most frustrating thing in the world for so many lifters, but everybody else on the internet's like, it's cheating. You're pulling sumo. I was like, just give it a shot, bro.
It's taken me a year to like fully figure sumo out, like to a place where I am consistently able to hit the same form and hit it well. So anyone who says that sumo is not a challenge has never tried sumo or is still doing wide stance conventional when they think they're doing sumo.
Yeah.
So, you know, like giving those lifters that will probably experience the most post-meet blues, giving them a specific challenge. Like, you know, maybe it's they want to bring their grip in and they want to try a close grip bench press for their main bench press, or switching to sumo, or even like trying out wraps, I guess, if you want to do that, high bar, low bar, whatever that lifter needs or whatever they mentioned to me, like in their prep, like, oh, after this prep, I think I want to try sumo. That's what I'll throw in for them afterwards. You know, like the first week post-meet, I do like more GPP style things and there'll be more conditioning and they generally don't do any axial loading because they need a break. So once it gets back to their actual training, I'll switch their deadlift to like sumo. Or if I know that they really, really like a movement, like they just love front squats, I'll make sure that I give them front squats like once a week.
They're sadistic bastards.
Yeah, it's so dumb. I hate it. or even like I have a couple of lifters who have a lot of access to strongman equipment. So like their Saturday is just like a strongman fun kind of day. And I let them do, you know, they'll play with stones or like do like the Husafell carries or like yoke or something like that. So something just to keep it entertaining for them without just being like, all right, well, Monday we're going to go back to bench press, you know, 3x5. And then tomorrow you're going to high bar and whatever. So I think that just paying attention to what the lifter likes, what they mention that they're interested in trying, and kind of developing their program around that post meet can be really, really helpful in getting rid of that post-meet blues. But I think it's going to happen regardless. But you kind of just have to remember that, like, this process isn't always the most exciting. Like, peaking and stuff is exciting because you're hitting more numbers, but you're literally just doing, like, one squat, one bench, one deadlift to hit more numbers. Like, it's not an exciting process.
The reality is those who get more excited for the mundane are usually the ones who progress the most.
Yeah.
And that's a mindset. You know, those 4 sets of 10 in the off, and that's putting muscle on your pecs or putting muscle on your quads at high bar. Those are those building reps. Those are the ones that you should be most excited about because that's your potential for later. So if you're only excited about the peaking phase and the heavy weights, then it just shows what you want to be doing. You don't really want to be building. You just want to be testing.
Yeah.
And that's okay. You know, you're doing this for you. It's totally fine.
For sure. Definitely. I think Riley made a good point with like, it's going to be different for everyone. You know, obviously you pick the sport that's fucking most boring sport. Right? Like, unfortunately you're stuck benching and deadlifting and squatting. Like, that's the sport you chose. Like, that's what you got to do, you know. But if you have someone who wants to be the best, you know, then the mundane, the monotony of it, that's just, it is what it is, right? And as a coach, I think it's coming to a clear definition of what the next process is, what the next step is, and being able to define that to the person, because you're always trying to get better. You don't want to be that person that gets these post-meet blues and doesn't train for 2 months, and then they come back and they've regressed, and then they're upset that they've regressed. And it's like, you can always get better at something. Mm-hmm. So as a coach, it's your job to define what that something is. And this happens a lot with nutrition and bodybuilding. You know, people do a show, and then at the end of the show, their coach is like, hey, see you later. It was fun while it lasted. And the person puts on like 50 pounds post show because they have no guidance of what they're doing next. They have no idea of what they should be building, what other things. So if you have someone that's truly goal oriented, which I'm not a huge fan of. But you know, if you look at the studies, right, where it shows, the one study that I'm very familiar with is the kids who love to draw, and they would draw all the time. And then as soon as their teacher gave them a reward for drawing, they quit wanting to draw. So I think a lot of lifters have this extrinsic drive to hit a certain number or to perform at a certain capacity at a meet. And as soon as they get that, their desire to get better is not really there anymore. So if they can focus on it being an intrinsic process, and like Riley said, where you just enjoy the process of, hey, you know, now I'm going into reps and now I'm trying to hit rep PRs instead of single PRs. And maybe my PRs are going to be on hack squat instead of on barbell squats, you know, and those type of things. Continue that person, if that's that mentality that person has, where they just want to continue to justifiably, like objectively say, these are the progressions that I'm making, these are the numbers that I'm hitting, what do I need to do next? Then define that for that person, give that person those goals to hit, and you just keep working towards that. And then if you have someone who's just purely about the process, then those are the people you can have more fun with. You can take time to regress, learn new moves, put in new things, and continue to have it be something that's a little bit more you know, fun, right? But mm-hmm. you also think about personality types, right, too. Like extroverts who always want to have that high arousal curve, they want variety, they want variation in their lifts. And then you have introverts who can just fucking do the same thing all the time. Monotony is like what they're, where they live. But in order to be good at anything that you do, you have to put in the work. You know, you can't do a meet, get ready for a meet 12 weeks and then have a 2 month lag and then get ready for a meet 12 weeks and think that you're going to make the progression, right? It's a matter of discipline and building that discipline within enjoying the process and knowing that, hey, you know, it may not be the most fun to get to the gym and do these lifts, but I have a goal. My coach explained my goal. And now I can just show up and do the work. And I know that on meet day, whether that be a year from now or 2 years from now, that I'm going to improve because I didn't let things slip up. So I think it's just a matter of prioritizing and having a different perspective on what you want out of lifting, right? And if you only want that total, then you're always going to have these issues with like post-meet blues because your total is not going to be there when you train, you know?
Not when you train, you can't always maintain that. And if you miss it, you know, and you're not competing again for 4, 5, 6, like you said, maybe even a year, it's a long way away before you get that chance again. So yeah. That's what causes the depression. And you hit the nail on the head with, you know, smaller objective goals that are unique. Like you mentioned introverts, and I have a great one example, like Ashley Garcia. You know, she was prepping for a meet and she's like, I really want to squat 405 times 10 in sleeves. And we did. And then of course she had this huge rep PR squat. And then she's like, I really want to hit 5 plates on the hack squat for a set of 10. And she did.
Right.
And then her squat's PRing. And now she's like, I really want to hit this number for this amount of reps with high bar, which is the phase we're in now before this block throw. Do you think we can get there? I'm like, hey, I'll give you that chance. Let's go aim for it. But she's not saying I want to PR my deadlift. I want to PR my max low bar squat. I want to PR my bench. She's saying I want to hit these intrinsic numbers, which is the training process. And she keeps getting stronger and stronger and stronger because she's looking for that weird, obscure number that shows progress without actually testing progress.
Yeah, I think the dopamine spike from like meet day that people get on social media is another thing that brings people down, is because, you know, you compete and you hit all your PRs and you post them online and everyone's like, wow, awesome, you know, like good job, you killed it. And then like the next week you post your training and you have like, like a 4x8 on squats. So like no one cares.
60%. Yeah. You know? Killed it last week and this week it killed you.
Yeah. And like, you know, and then kind of no one cares anymore. And you're like, wow, my training. Then you realize like, oh, my training's really boring right now. And so I think that I noticed that a lot of the lifters that I have that don't post a lot online are the ones that tend to enjoy just the process more. You know, like obviously if you post online, like we all post online, you know, like that's not a big deal. But the ones who like really, really love the process, they don't care if they have somewhere to post their things. They don't care if someone likes their thing. They're just there to lift. And I still have lifters that can't go back to the gym right now because they're in like the New York and New Jersey area and like gyms are still closed. And like I have one girl, Leah, who's in her basement and it's like a scary basement. This is where horror movies happen. And she has a barbell and she has enough plates that she can have and like one kettlebell right now. And you know, she's been like this since quarantine started. So since March, and I feel bad sometimes sending her program because I'm like, there's not a whole lot of like different things that she can be doing, but every single block, she finds a way to be more excited about what she's doing, whether that's like literally something like, oh, I maintained better tension on the hole in my squat. Like she is very, very invested in like the process and the small details. And yes, she wants to see her numbers grow, but she's so focused on like, okay, if I can make all these other things better, then my numbers will increase. And I feel like that is missing for a lot of people. Like they're not looking at like the small things that they can make better. They're just overall looking at like, well, my squat didn't go up 20 pounds. So why am I doing this? You know? And that's not the right way to approach things. Like you have to pay attention to the small things. Like you mentioned with like Ashley's, you know, SSB squat, like that was a major PR and her squat went up after that. Yep. It's like these things lead to those bigger numbers. So you have to be focused on those too.
She was very big on the process of chasing rep goals with certain lifts rather than single weight. Yeah. It was cool.
Yeah. I find that too. Like the people who post on social media constantly, they're so fucking annoying to work with because they're the ones that like go off program. They're the ones that like always have an excuse or they always have negative connotations to their posts. And it's like, fuck, now I gotta wait for this check-in to come in and it's gonna be like super negative because social media is, you know, engulfing their brain. And it's just like, man, it just drives me crazy. And you know, something you touched on too is like, you know, what are you training for? Are you training for validation through social media? Are you, I get this with nutrition clients a lot, is they'll, you know, maybe the scale's not moving. They're like, it's just such a waste of time to eat healthy. I'm like, do you like, think about what you just said. It's just because the scale's not moving, it's a waste of time to eat healthy. Do you feel better? Are you performing better? It's like, yeah, yeah, but the scale's not moving. It's like, what's your other option? What's your other option? Like, to just eat whatever you want and gain 20 more pounds? And the same thing with lifting. Like, oh, you don't want to go to the gym today? Oh, that's adorable. Like, what else are you going to do? Just fucking watch Netflix and feel bad about yourself and not improve? Like, that's, I don't, you know, it's all about like perspective and the opportunity to go to the gym when you get to train is something that we take for granted a lot. And it's just, you know, find a way to constantly remind yourself, like, this is an amazing opportunity to just get better and improve day to day. And, you know, I think that's the best way to approach it.
Yeah. Unless your goal is literally to sit on the couch, get fat and unhealthy, you're going to have to do something.
Yeah. And if you need a coach for that, you know,
I will hire me. I'll coach you into sitting still and watching Netflix and eating ice cream. I am a pro at it.
I saw, you know who Ben Bruno is, right?
Oh yeah.
He made a post the other day. It was fucking hilarious. He was laying on his couch and he was like, I didn't know 10 years ago when I invented couch side planks that this would revolutionize the industry come 2020. Talking about how everyone just laying on the couch getting fat right now. He's like, I didn't know this exercise was going to be such a revolutionary thing. I thought that was hilarious.
Man loves single leg work like no other.
Yeah, yeah. Did you not get the reference? Can you explain that to him after the show, Riley, please?
He's talking about like laying on the couch. Like he was being facetious.
Okay. No, I didn't get that part. I thought it was like a legit post. Like maybe he said side plank on the couch and everyone's watching Netflix and side planking and tagging him. I don't know.
I feel like you're not a good listener, Trevor. We need to have an intervention about this. You're not a good listener. You're always just trying to think of the next thing to say.
I'm sorry I don't scroll through social media as often as you do.
Well, I didn't.
It's not a matter of social media. It's a matter of listening to your partner, looking me in the eyes, and listening to me, and fully grasping exactly what I'm saying. You don't ever listen.
What is it? It's not me. It's you.
Okay. Also, Trevor. To be fair, I did not see this post, and I still understood that.
Do you know who Ben Bruno is?
No, but I understood the joke.
Okay. I know who Ben Bruno is. So 50%. We're a team together here.
You put it together.
So she got the joke. I know who the person is.
That's right. All right. Next question.
Okay, moving past that.
We got pretty much asking, you know, what are some indicators? He asked, have you ever had a lifter become injured from too low a volume as opposed to exceeding maximum recoverable volume? And the idea is like, you know, can you like, what are the mechanisms of injury? Like, how do people get injured? Is it necessarily a volume thing? Is it a intensity thing? Like, what in your mind creates injury for a lot of the lifters? Because I don't necessarily think that it's derivative of like max, like if you hit MRV, that doesn't necessarily mean you're gonna get injured. And if you're starting off your block at a max, like a lower volume, that doesn't necessarily mean you're not going to get injured, right? So what do you guys think are the determining factors that lifters should think about when assessing injuries?
I've never heard of someone getting injured from too low a volume, because usually if your volume is really, really low, your recovery is really high. I mean, you'd have to have no volume whatsoever and be so deconditioned that, like you said, you know, you run out and play pickup basketball, you strain a hamstring because you're just not conditioned to that at all.
Also think about low volume as like a heavy single.
Okay, so low volume and high intensity. See, that's another indicator that he didn't discuss. He just said too low of a volume.
Right.
So if you're always lifting at maximal loads, then yeah, you probably are increasing your chance of injury because you're always lifting at maximal loads. These are near max loads. These are your absolute output as opposed to sub-max loads and maybe more volume. So a few key indicators that usually can contribute but not necessarily the cause is, you know, fatigue, which we know that. So lack of recovery. I'm going to use fatigue in two different terms here because sometimes it's too much volume in the program and someone's just not recovering and they break down from fatigue. You know, those are usual itises. Your elbows hurt, your knees hurt, your back hurts, whatever, on occasion, or it's stiff. That's the overuse itis. You know, that's an overuse fatigue. And then there's like the poor recovery fatigue, the guy who eats like shit, stays up all night playing Xbox and drinks 17 beers on a weekend because it's Saturday. And then he goes in and pulls his max deadlift on Monday. Well, he's just not recovering from week to week because he has a shitty lifestyle. That's a different type of fatigue. But both of them can equally contribute to aches, pains, and injuries. Sometimes, and people will argue this left and right, I do think mechanics of your form can also contribute to your injury. If you are lifting in a less than optimal path, you probably do put more shearing force on one joint or one tendon than you ideally should. I mean, is it a guarantee that poor mechanics are going to be an injury? No, but we know that if you lift more efficiently and create a more stable base and have adequate mobility, you're probably less likely to strain or pull something because you have better movement quality. If anyone who argues movement quality is kind of crazy, because we don't want people to go out there and move like shit just so they can move something from point A to point B, we want them to have a quality of life, and that means better movement quality. It means less restriction. But so we really don't know what the cause of an actual injury is. Like my pec, you know, my recovery was great. My hydration was great. That was my backup work. It wasn't even heavy. And volume wasn't even that high at that time, because I started dropping volume down as I'm getting closer to the meet. Some things just happened, like you and I talked about, that could have been fraying over a very, very long time. And by the time I'd already pulled the volume, reduced it down, it was too much for me as I'm getting older, and it just went on its own. That was the straw that broke the camel's back. So we don't understand injury enough, but we do understand that we can try to prevent it as much as possible by having a healthier lifestyle, having adequate recovery as far as getting enough sleep, hydration, and nutrition. Not overdoing our workout, not overdoing our intensity too often, not overdoing the program, and having quality movement mechanics. Can we guarantee you'll never get injured? No, you're testing yourself in this sport. You are going to test yourself under absolute maximal loads. The likelihood of you hurting yourself is higher than somebody who's sitting on a couch. Does that mean he's going to be healthier than you? No, he can hurt his back too. Slip and fall, just poor posture, whatever. He's going to hurt himself
sneeze
too.
Sneeze really hard.
Exactly.
Right. I mean, exactly. I've seen it all.
Exactly. But, you know, you just want to do your best to reduce the possibility of getting hurt. And having too low of a volume probably isn't the cause, but maybe too frequent of a maximal intensity could contribute. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people get away with that when they're 18, 19, 21, 22. But as you approach 33 and you have kids, wife, mortgage, and job, your stress levels are higher. You probably can't do maximal training all the time. The Bulgarian method is no longer for you because you're not 12 anymore. You know? The Bulgarian method was very effective when, one, they were using steroids. We know that now. And two, their entire job was their performance.
Yeah.
And they, even them, who had no other obligations other than train because that was their job, they still burnt out within a 3.5 to 4 year period. So genetics. The next Olympic cycle was something else. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So we have to understand that there are only so many maxes you can take. And the older you get, the higher your training age gets, and the higher your life stress gets, the less often you should be taking maximal work. Unless you're getting ready for a meet, you should be working at predominantly submax or high enough intensity and load that you're working on hypertrophy or size. You just have to be smart in those choices. So even though the guy probably has the right idea with a somewhat lower volume because he's maximally loading, he's lifting at maximal loads too long.
Right. Yeah. And I also think too, because I think whatever you just touched on was like perfect. Those are really great mechanisms to think about. Fatigue is a huge one, right? Because usually in those higher rep ranges with the higher volume, I don't think it's the volume that causes the injury. I think it's the fatigue of not being in shape, not being able to keep those proper mechanics that causes that injury over time. But if you are in low volume, then you're not really progressing. So there's a fine line of like, I need to push volume enough to progress, but I don't want to be so high a volume that I have to deload every 2 weeks or else I'm going to get injured, right? You don't want to be like me where it's like, oh, and every time I get injured, that's my deload week. It's like, no, you don't want to do it. It's not a good strategy.
Ideally, we deload before that. Yeah,
right.
Ideally.
But I also think forced movement is another one too. Like, you know, forced ranges of motion that people put their bodies under because they think they need to go through a full range of motion is another way to increase your risk of injury, right? If you think about it in terms of like an overhead press or an incline bench, now that we have video, we can like demonstrate this stuff. So, right? So if you're doing an overhead press, right? And this is like your start position here. Why? And like I'm forcing it down and there's no way I'm getting to my clavicle. So then why would you ever start the bar on your clavicle? Right? That just makes no sense. And lat pull downs, right? If you're doing a lat pull down and you pull it here and it's like at nose level, why would you ever try to touch your chest, right? You're just putting your rotator cuff in such a compromised position and your shoulder joint in such a compromised position. Same thing with squats. Like if you can't hit a bodyweight squat to full depth, don't be that asshole that's like, oh, I just don't have enough weight on the bar. It's like, you take a shit, right? Or do you need somebody to push you down to take a shit? Like, what are you talking about? You should be able to perform a squat properly with no bar, you know? And if you can't, and then you put a bar on your back and you're forcing yourself into those ranges of motion, that's going to cause an injury too over time. So I think that's a big thing as well. It's just forcing yourself into those extreme ranges of motion that you're not ready to make yet.
Yeah. And being, we talk about this all the time, is the difference between active and passive ranges of motion.
Yeah.
You know, some people can drop into a full split, which she can passively, but she didn't have the active hip mobility to do that under load when she started sumo. She had to work on acquiring that active mobility as opposed to her passive mobility.
Yeah. I can pretty much always do a split, but my sumo is pretty narrow for most people, like with how tall, like my length of my legs and how tall I am, it's pretty narrow because I don't have that. But I think that, with the movement too, I think that that's important to touch on because a lot of people try to mimic what other people are doing, or like coaches try to force lifters to lift the exact same way that they're lifting.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like you'll see people that bench really, really wide and with a super high arch, or they bench like really, or excuse me, they squat really, really close and like a really, really low bar, or, you know, sumo really, really wide or conventional really, really close. And that, like, that coach is teaching their lifters to lift in that way, but that might not be optimal for them. So they're going to break down eventually if they're trying to move maximal loads in a movement pattern that doesn't make sense for them. Like, not everyone needs to be lifting the exact same way. You shouldn't be copying the way that your favorite lifter on the internet lifts either.
Unless it's me. And then I'm just happy that I'm your favorite lifter.
That's very true. Yeah. I mean, if you're not taking in some morphological factors as a coach, like, you're just doing your athletes a disservice, right? Like, if you don't have those Asian bones, you're not going to be a high bar squatter with huge quads, right? Because that's just what they do. You know, you can't force that upon people. You can't, if your shoulder's fucked up, you want somebody to have an extreme low bar position and they just fuck their shoulder up every time they do that. Well, then what are you doing as a coach? You're just putting people in these positions that they can't maintain, you know, especially if they have any type of pain or any type of external tightness. How are you going to maintain a proper brace when all you're worried about is like, my shoulders feel like they're going to snap off and stuff like that. So yeah, all good points for sure.
That was a good one.
Yes, sir. Next question you have.
We got something that could be like rapid fire. Tips and strategies for dealing with ongoing joint pain, shoulders, hips, elbows. So you're hurting in three spots. And like we just talked about in that last one, that's probably too much volume. You know,
find a new sport,
not enough
man.
Recovery. That's a bit too much work or not enough recovery that you're getting those itis pains. That's a quick one. You know, you need to evaluate your volume and your exercise selection possibly.
It could also, yeah, exercise selection is a big one because morphology is huge on that, right? Like, people have elbow pain because they're doing, like, say they're doing barbell curls, you know, it's like naturally your arms tend to like, go away from your body as you put them down. No one's arms are going to go directly down by their side. But when you have a barbell curl in that fixed position, you're just fucking yourself up. Same thing with like skull crusher, same thing with anything that's going to put you in a fixed position that you shouldn't be in a fixed position for, because you're not thinking about shoulder girdle, hip girdle, anything like that. That's where those itises come in from, you know, because you're low bar squatting and you don't know how to engage your lats. So you're just sitting everything on your biceps, then your biceps can be fucked up.
Or like you mentioned, people wedging their hands in too tight because a tighter grip is more controlled and they're causing compression. Yeah. So exercise selection and form. There was another quick one here. Tips for a sleeved high bar lifter transitioning to wraps. Can't get forward knee travel well. That's easy. Widen your stance. If you're going to lift in wraps and you can't get the knees to go forward because you're too narrow, then you either have to A, lower the bar, or B, widen your stance.
or try different wraps too. Like, I guess, you know, like depending on the type of
a cast wrap is not going to be ideal if you're a very narrow squatter. You need a wrap that's going to move. So you need more of a springy wrap, a soft wrap.
Yeah.
That might help you.
Also too, making sure that just because your knees aren't like, if your knees travel forward so much and your hips don't have a place to go as well. So you want to make sure that you're opening up your hips so that they can actually hit depth. Cause that happened to G a lot of times. G is a very forward knee squatter and he would just let his knees keep traveling forward. And he thought he hit depth cause there was nowhere else to go, but his hips were still fucking high because he just allowed them to travel forward. He didn't actually allow them to open up and let his hips drop in. So I think it's just maybe your squat mechanics isn't the greatest either. You know, if that's the case.
At least not for wraps.
Not for wraps, yeah. And wraps aren't for everyone. You know, that also goes without saying is you don't have to do wraps because it's the popular thing. If you're going to do wraps, you might have to accommodate the wrap itself, which means either a softer wrap, a different stance, or a different position to utilize the wraps. Just because you are a raw squatter narrow and high bar doesn't mean you're going to be a rap squatter narrow and high bar.
Yeah. Also, just because you throw wraps on doesn't mean you're instantly going to gain like 50 pounds to your squat. I think I actually squat more sleeved than I do wraps at the moment. So
yeah, expectations and allowing time to practice in the wraps is huge.
All right. One of these we've answered a lot, so I don't want to skip that one. So I'm going to appease Alexis here because she's dropped some questions in. What are your opinions on rest pause training for bench? Likes, dislikes, better alternatives? everyone jumping at once.
What's the point? Like, what's the goal? What are you trying to do with rest pauses?
That would be my first thing, is what are you hoping to achieve from it besides trying it?
So she mentioned this in the ritual group, and I answered this already in the ritual group. Her reasoning for it was that she sucks at volume or like hitting reps on bench. And like, I have personally done rest pause bench with previous coaches in previous programs. And like it gets changed in the way that people do it. Like Trevor and I talked about traditional rest pause is supposed to be, you know, you do a weight, you rack it, you take like three breaths, you do the same weight again, and you pyramid down in rep schemes. But some other ways that it's getting programmed is you take whatever percentage of your rep you do for max reps, and you rack it, and then you rest for 45 seconds, and then you go do it again, and you do max amount of reps, and then you rest for 20 seconds, and then you go back and do it again after 20 seconds for as many reps as you can, and then you're done. So to me, like if I think about 45 seconds, realistically, that's about how I do like my speed work. Like that's about how much time I'm in between like rest of my speed work that I do. Right. So 45 seconds is a long time to me to be resting for. So I don't necessarily
that wouldn't be rest pause. Yeah.
Yeah. Like that's not, yeah, it's supposed to be like three breaths. Personally, when I did rest pause, I did not feel like I got a lot from it. I got really tired and that's about it. But I don't know that I like actually increased my capacity with being able to do volume for bench, because I still am not good at volume on bench. Right. Like it's still something that I struggle with. And the way that I've gotten better at doing volume on bench is by doing more volume on bench.
that's specific to the goal, is more volume on bench, because rest pause is also you're working in a range that it's loads that are more hypertrophy specific. Mm-hmm. So I'll give you an example of this. I know that Josh Bryant has it in his bench press manual, but it's in the beginning phase of the bench press manual. It's not in the peaking phase or improving your bench. It's basically a builder. Mm-hmm. So he has it written out that you would take a weight that you can do 10 reps with, and you do 8 reps with it, rack it, take 3 breaths, and keep doing triples until you can't anymore. When you mm-hmm. fail a triple, you're done with it. So ideally, if the weight is something you can normally do 10 reps with, you probably got somewhere between 12 to 15 or maybe even 17 or 18 reps with it in that one cluster or rest pause type set than you would have as opposed to getting 10 reps with it kind of thing. And the goal was to get more reps in, like you said, at a certain load. But those aren't strength loads. Those are hypertrophy loads. Mm-hmm. So if you have a lack of pec size, it's probably a great way to build your pec size. It is not the best way to build your bench, because as fatigue accrues, your form is going to deteriorate. And for someone like, and this isn't like, Alexa sent me her videos yesterday. When she reps the bench, she protracts pretty hard at her lockouts. She's overdoing the lockout. She's losing her scapular retraction and she's losing her shoulders off the bench. So her struggles with reps become she's losing position. So she's in a less stable base. Doing something that's going to encourage you to lift fatigue is probably going to encourage that poor motor pattern. It's not going to help build your lift. It's going to deteriorate over time because you're reinforcing a bad motor pattern.
Yeah, she wouldn't be improving her stability at all in that. She would just be improving how much she can just push the weight away from her in whatever fashion that she can. So like in that instance, if like stability is the issue, then like doing long pause work for reps is going to be more beneficial, in my opinion, than doing like rest pause. Like it's just, I feel like personally for me, when I was doing rest pause is when I felt like my shoulders felt the shittiest. Like I don't have any problems now, but when I was doing rest pause is like when my shoulders would hurt more, because you're just trying to focus on however many reps you can push out at like 60% or something. And that ended up being too much volume on a day that I was supposed to be doing more speed work or more rep maxes or something, or rep max day or something like that. So personally, I just feel like there are better ways to improve volume on bench. Like I mentioned, just doing more volume on bench.
More
like
sets.
If that's, you know, like even if it's inverting the volume, like if you have a hard time holding stability for more than 3 to 4 reps, maybe you should be doing 8 sets of 3 or 9 sets of 3 and inverting your volume instead of like 3 sets of 10.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. More practice.
To internet gurus, you're not supposed to retract your shoulder blades on bench press treadmill. So that's probably what the problem is. You have her doing things she's not supposed to do. But I think I mean, I think if the goal is like, hey, I need to improve my bench volume, add in intensifiers to your actual workout doesn't improve your bench volume, right? One, how do you quantify that? How do you improve on that week to week? Two, what is that doing to your recovery potentiality, right? Like, they've done plenty of research showing that, you know, rest pause sets to traditional sets are more fatiguing, creates more of a recovery demand, and isn't necessarily more valuable than the actual straight set volume. In Alexa's case, based on what you said, Trevor, is that like, hey, your technique is shitty when you do volume stuff and you're not able to quantify each rep. So the stimulus is not the same because you're just trying to move weight. You're not actually trying to do the exercise as it is intended, right? If you just think about, hey, I just want to complete 10 reps and reps 7, 8, 9, and 10 look like shit because you're just trying to complete 10 reps, then that's also building a lot of fatigue and a lot of demand. And the only way to get better, like Riley said, the only way to get better at fucking volume, I don't understand how people say, I just suck at volume. Well, how long have you been doing volume for? I just started. Oh, where'd you come from? I was doing singles. Oh, well, I don't know. Maybe give it a, you know, 6 months. Like, how do you expect to get better at something if you don't put in the time to get better at it? Specificity reigns supreme. And if you're trying to become a more voluminous bencher, you know, then fucking bench more. You know?
The answer is usually pretty simple. I had someone today in one of my lifters asked me like how to get better at front squats. And my answer was more front squats.
More front squats.
Like that's, you know, like the answer is usually very simple. If you suck at something, you have to do it more. Like a skill gets better the more that you develop it. So if you suck at something, you kind of have to do that. Like there's not a shortcut to be able to like swap something with something in order for the other thing to get better.
Yeah. I had a similar lifter to Alexis who did the same thing, who would protract so hard his shoulders would come off the bench. And I'm like, you know what? Let's try something a little different. Bench only 90% of the way, 90-95% of the way. Stop shy of lockout except for the very last rep of every set. And that was like a game changer for him. It's like bench feels so easy now because his shoulders actually stayed in contact with the bench. He had a much more stable platform to push off of. Robert was able to do that. So with Alexis, I'd probably look to do the same thing, is have her stop shy of lockout for all of her reps except for the last one.
Time under tension, bro.
Yep. Killed that's it. Going to build the pecs. Yep. Time under tension is going to build the pecs.
And so someone like Alexis in that situation where she's not able to maintain proper form, what I would do as a coach, and if you want to hire me, ditch your coach, feel free to, because he's a jerk. It's like, say instead of giving her 3 sets of 10, right? Just be like, hey, I want you to do 30 perfect reps. Complete that however you want to. This is your load. As soon as you hit an imperfect rep, it doesn't count. 30 perfect reps. And then she can fucking cluster it. She can rest pause it. She can do whatever the fuck she wants to do with it as long as she gets those 30 reps and doesn't change the load, right? Like, you know, as long as it's perfect reps. Because that's the important thing, right? You don't want to start doing volume to chase volume as a powerlifter and then your technique goes to shit. If you spend 6 months in the offseason doing volume work and you're bench pressing and half of those reps look like shit, well, it's going to be hard to technically be proficient when it gets to the heavier stuff because 50% of your reps look like shit, right? So don't just chase numbers, chase perfection of the actual movements, because that's the biggest thing when it comes to powerlifting. How good is your technique? Oh, your technique's perfect. Then you can quantify every single rep that you're doing and you know that you're getting better.
Absolutely. Quality reps is going to build quality results.
Yeah,
that's right.
All right. So we got a few in there. We jumped them together there. Let me see what else we got here. Works out. Recently strained my pecs. How long should I feel before starting rehab using bands, etc.? That's another quick one we can get to. And rehab starts immediately. Blood flow is the healing process. I would not rush that process, but you know, microdose a little bit more each day. And with the bands, if you strain your pec, you want to help it heal. You want to pump a lot of blood in there. And that's the first thing you usually do is take like a micro mini band and just knock out like 3 sets of 30 band presses 2 or 3 times a day to push that blood and just increase the intensity of the band, or isometric holds, like halfway down push-ups kind of thing, just holding the isometric tension to let the tissue capacity build up and stuff like that. But when you hurt something, rehab is immediately. The more you move, the better you're going to feel.
Yeah. As soon as Trevor strained his pec the other day or pulled his pec the other day, as soon as we got the bar unloaded, he immediately like went over, grabbed a band, started doing like flies,
band squeezes, flies, and just trying to tense it
just immediately. There's
blood through it.
There's no point in waiting. Like the longer that you let it sit there, the worse it's going to feel.
It's going to get stiff and uncomfortable.
Yeah, you want movement without pain is what you're trying to shoot for. So if there is a range of motion that you can do, work that range of motion as much as you can. And then if you can't go full range of motion without pain loaded, do full range of motion just in the air. Like get the blood moving, get some circulation, put a heating pad on if you can't get full range just to get blood to that area. You know, just simple things. But yeah, move as much as you can without causing pain. A good way to know if you've done too much is if the next day, does it feel worse or better? If it feels worse, you probably did too much. If it feels better, then you're on the right track. And just listen to your body and follow those cues.
That's crazy. Listen to your body. Hey. That's madness.
My coach is supposed to tell me what to do, not my body. How dare you?
Yeah. Right. I think we actually got to almost all these, except for this one. Best squatting program for quad hypertrophy. 6'2", 218 pounds. Macros, calories, okay. Thanks. I'm assuming he's European with the way that was worded. But talking about quad hypertrophy.
You sure about
I'm
that?
Assuming.
What made,
I'm
did
assuming.
He, like,
no.
Did he give us some I'm extra assuming. Little things on the top of
Are you a European expert?
I'm a European expert.
Have you ever been to Europe?
No.
Okay, fair enough.
But I read about it in a book.
That he didn't remember.
I've seen Euro Trip. What else do I need to know? I've seen Euro Trip. I'm good.
Scusi. That's a good movie.
It's the new Pope. Plus, I've seen European Vacation with Chevy Chase. It's awesome. Expert.
It is good.
Obviously, yeah. I can't argue that.
Amazing. You know, you're talking about quad-specific hypertrophy, so you're also looking at what your exercise selection is. If you are a low-bar squatter, that's the worst for quad-specific hypertrophy because you're going to be using your back and you're going to be using your hips.
That's the biggest thing, right? It's like, what do you, like squat program for quad hypertrophy. Like, what makes you think squats are going to build your quads?
I was just about to say squat may not even be your best bet of quad hypertrophy. You may want to start with a leg press and just put squats on maintenance after that. Yeah. You know, there's not a lot of pro bodybuilders under the but some of them are very strong. But if you're working specifically for quad hypertrophy, you'd want to take something from the bodybuilding world, and they're focused a lot on hack squats. They're focused a lot on lunges. They're focused a lot on leg press. They're not focused a lot on deep squats. Not recently, anyways.
Yeah. It's very simple, right? It's like you want to build a muscle, do the workout. At the end of the workout, I'm like, oh, where do you feel that at? Oh, I feel it in my knees and lower back. Guess what? You didn't fucking work your quads.
Especially simple. As a taller individual at 6'2", he's got a long way to go. There are things you can do to your squats, like the high bar or elevating your heels.
Yeah, really squat focus wedges on the are quads. Really good.
But the breakdown of that isn't going to be ideal to train at a heavy set. So you're going to be better off doing some isolation work like the leg press or even just the belt squat where you're taking your back out of it and focusing on the forward knee travel. Most of us in the powerlifting world, for as far as quad hypertrophy, are usually using belt squats if they have access to it. But a leg press is just as fantastic. A hack squat's fantastic. Sissy squats are fantastic. Step away from the barbell for your quad-specific hypertrophy for a little while. Put it in to maintain form afterwards, but prioritize the isolation of those quads first. And as far as calories and macros, well, that's just – there's no way for us to answer that for you. Yeah.
He said they're okay. Did you give like a thumbs up emoji? Because that would make it European.
I swear it was like one step away from thumbs up.
No, I don't think that. I think that he was saying that. What I gather from that response is that he's saying he's not gaining size. He's eating enough. To him, he's eating enough calories. His macros are appropriate for gaining, but he's probably having trouble putting mass onto his quads. That's what I gathered from the way that it was written, not that he was European or anything.
Lies. But, he's European.
So I think that he's saying that like he's eating well, or he thinks he's eating well. His nutrition is just having a hard time hitting that specific muscle group. But
yeah,
doesn't seem like squats are the thing to do.
Yeah, I always feel like when people say their macros are okay, means they're probably not. Okay. So
they usually don't know.
You should be gaining weight. If you want to put on size, try to gain some weight. If you want to not gain weight and put on size, you're fighting an uphill battle. But when it comes to hypertrophy, you want to think about taking the stability out of the movement and trying to create as much output as possible within the desired muscles that you're trying to use. Like I said, if you leave the workout and your fucking knees are aching and your lower back's pumped and your quads feel like they didn't do anything, then they probably didn't do anything, you know? So that's the way I would look. And if you're a power lifter, right, use the squat as your main movement to potentiate your hypertrophy. So say, I mean, there's some good research on post-activation potentiation where you can do whatever barbell squat. Say you just do a triple for that day, then you go and do some hack squats. The hack squats should feel lighter. And I know there's certain like time variances and stuff like that that can make that happen, but don't lose the technical skill of the squat, but don't let your squat be the driving force of your hypertrophy. Find those exercises that you feel in your quads the most. And that's typically going to be a hack squat, a leg press, leg extensions. I know people hate leg extensions and powerlifting. Like anything that's isolation, people are like, you shouldn't be doing that. That's not functional powerlifting. It's like, fuck are you talking about functional for? You can't even there's do a no, single yeah. leg movement. You can't even fucking so tie no your shoe. You want to talk about functional.
There's no function in our sport.
So it's just finding those movements where you're like, man, my quads are really pumped and they're burning, and then they'll start growing. I promise you that, as long as you're making sure that your macros are, make them better than okay, make them great, you know? And I mean, that's just the basic way to do it.
It just made me think of that. We talked about the function of the sport, how every powerlifter realized like leg extensions is such an unfunctional movement, but then they're going to be at a meet. Like, can you pull my strap up for my singlet? I can't reach.
Can you tie my shoes?
Can you scratch my back? I can't reach my shoulder.
Chalk my back. I can't reach back here.
Yeah. And the sad thing is that people hear that and they think that like, oh, we'll never do leg extensions. But yet there's some really good research out there showing that, hey, leg extensions after knee surgery is one of the best ways to build up quad strength and to go through ranges of motion. And it's like, ditch all that functional shit and just use common sense sometimes. And people don't ever want to do that. They, you know, like Riley said earlier, people are always looking for like this fancy new thing or this new idea to make their training better. And it's like, it's very basic.
They're always looking for an excuse not to have to do what's really hard and really uncomfortable. That's what a lot of people are doing. Like, I pulled this study out and it says, I don't have to do this. It's like, that study didn't do your total. That study didn't get anything. That study didn't win anything. That study hasn't coached anyone. Yeah. That's a small 8-week study involving 19-year-olds.
But it's in trained
subjects.
Or
untrained people.
Yeah, or they'll be like, it's in trained subjects. And it's like, what's the squat? Oh, 100 kilos. In men? Oh, that's cute. That's cute. That's really trained for sure. Yeah. Yeah, no, that's definitely the disconnect between science and practical application is the training subjects are never going to be intermediates or elite level lifters. So it's better to anecdotally think about some of that stuff too.
I was discussing with Dave Osborne literally yesterday about one of the posts I made in my stories. And I was like, how some people will cherry pick the recent research when it's using those studies, you know, an 8-week or 10-week study on daily unyielding periodization involving, like you said, well-trained individuals who have like a 250-pound or you know, a 300-pound squat and that they're considered well-trained. Meanwhile, like Verkhoshansky studies and Pralapins are like on Olympic level athletes who competed over, you know, 4 Olympic cycles, 16 years of research on the highest level of athletes. And people will discard that entirely and go with the 8-week study because it fits their agenda.
Right.
Like you said, it's cherry picking. It's, yeah. Like, it's what they want.
Confirmation bias at its finest. Like, oh, Verkhoshansky didn't, where's his p-value at? He didn't go through the IRB. It's like, fuck you talking like Bondarchuk, all those guys. Like, how are you not taking their research? You know, even like people discredit Louis Simmons. Like, are you fucking kidding me? He's been doing this for over 60 years, producing the best lifters in the world all the time.
Like, it's just hyper specific to Multiply. He'll be the first to tell you. He's like, research, my opinions, my findings are specific to the Multiply squat or the Multiply bench or the Multiply deadlift. They're not to anything else.
Yet he has UFC fighters, Ohio State track athletes, football players, some of the best.
Soccer.
Yeah, it's like, he knows what the fuck he's talking about. Like,
Stipe Miocic goes over there to work on his power and his strength and conditioning. And they utilize the same principles of force production and maximal effort, but he's not doing it with a barbell squat.
And this is the problem too, because when I was in Ohio, Louis, like, I wish Ohio State would reach out to me and I'd do some studies. I'd love to do some studies on all my stuff. And that happens a lot. Ben Bukowski is another one. He wanted to do a case study because he's dieting for the Olympia. And it would have been awesome to do a case study on him. But it's just like, there's so many things that go on that prohibit people from actually doing like really good research. Because like, yeah, I mean, it's a fucking N=1 case study, but like, it's pretty fucking awesome. It's Ben Bukowski.
On the highest level athlete, as opposed to your recreational gym goer at LA Fitness who wants his partial credit for lab.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's very different.
I get it, right? Like being in there, being inundated with it now, I understand the research process and exactly how limited you are. Like, people aren't going to fucking, top level lifters are never going to sign up for research projects because, you know how it is. Like, you're not going to go to a place and they're gonna be like, here's your program. Like, this is fucking stupid. I don't want to do this program. And then,
I mean, they reached out. The FAU research lab reached out to me when I lived down there a couple years ago. And they're like, hey, can you come in on Tuesday and we can test the velocity of your squat? I'm like, sure. And then sure enough, on Monday, they're like, oh, by the way, we need you to take a max squat. I'm like, no, it's actually my deload week. I'm not going to do that.
Right.
And they're like, well, we need to test you under a max load. I'm like, I promise you, I lift with compensatory acceleration. I'm going to have the same velocity on the bar, whether it's 600 pounds or 60 pounds. It's going to go up as fast as I push it. I'm like, you didn't need that. But that's what they were trying to force. And I'm like, I'm not taking a max in the middle of your lab on a Tuesday during my deload week.
You just don't get it.
Who's going to be spotting you too? Jesus.
Yeah.
Not yeah. Yeah. Hopefully, you know, the good thing is that I think a lot more people, competitors, at least from what I've seen, are getting into the research. So I think you never know. You know, I hope if good coaches and good athletes become researchers that they'll be able to get a little bit more, but you know, there's funding too. Nobody wants to fund elite level athletes either.
No.
Oh, you want to make the best better? You're not going to get funding for that. We're trying to cure cancer. We're trying to cure cancer. You just want to fucking increase somebody's vertical leap by 2 inches? Not going to happen.
Until vertical leap, you know, vertical leap will cure cancer. All right.
Yeah. Here's some money for you, for sure. So I do understand the limitations. It's frustrating as athletes, and it's frustrating to not have the research that you want. And then you have these fucking, like you said, these confirmation bias people where it's like, look at this research, like Brad Schoenfeld's hypertrophy, 45 sets. Like 3 sets of 10 on squats to failure, 3 sets of 10 on this to failure, 60-second rest. Like, who the fuck is completing this workout? Not a single goddamn person that can actually lift any real weight. This is ridiculous.
So. Yeah. People just want to fit their own agenda when it comes to something, like whether that's getting better at a movement, they want it to fit their own agenda. They don't want to do what's hard. They don't want to read something that discredits what they've already been saying. Like, people aren't willing to be wrong in that sense. Like,
yeah, you know. I was reading a neuroscience paper talking about we get just as much dopamine hits by getting our biases confirmed by other people. So that's why we continue to like search out for confirmation bias, for people to tell us that we're doing things right, because we get those dopamine hits, just like on Instagram where people are doing likes and sharing your stuff. Even if it's wrong information, if people are sharing it, that's going to keep hitting those dopamine signals, and you're going to keep wanting to fucking give out wrong information or continue to have your biases. So it's really hard to change your biases because dopamine's telling you like, hey, let's just keep feeding this. Let's just keep feeding this beast, instead of being like, well, maybe I should take a step back. And like I talked about earlier, Cal Dietz, he's like, the reason I answer all, like I have all this cool training stuff is because every time I come up with something, I think to myself, well, how can I make it better? And that's what you should always do as a coach, is like, don't ever rest on your laurels thinking like, oh, I have the perfect template. Like, this is perfect. This works for everyone. Cause I hear that all the time. I've been to seminars where like, this is the absolute best way and the only way to set up for bench press. It's the perfect, it's the best way. It's like, what are you talking about? That makes no sense at all.
It's impossible.
So then it's like, well, and now that you said that, you're never going to try to refine that. Like, you're never going to try to figure out what's wrong with it, because you already think it's the best. So as coaches, it's constantly questioning what you believe in and what you're doing. And then that's when you start coming up with these creative concepts and all this creativity within your programs. And I think that's definitely missed a lot with coaches.
Well, the application is what's missed, is that people can find out what works best for them, but they may not be able to figure out what works best for 3 of their lifters, like based off of many different factors, but they're basing it what works for them. And they think that that's gospel because they did so well with it and that everyone has to do it. And that's when people make Facebook posts about really dumb things that like make no sense. And they want everyone to jump on the train and do their thing.
Yeah.
This was every 1980s high school football coach. This is how I did it. So this is how you're going to do it.
Right. That is true. Yeah. Awesome. Well, that is it. That's all the questions we have, right?
Yep. We're good.
All right. Perfect. Well, appreciate you guys for listening. Thank you, Riley, for coming on.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. It was a pleasure. Do you want to promote your stuff that you have going on?
Sure. So you can follow me on Instagram, which is at Riley Presnell. I do have a website that has like different templates on it, like my t-shirts and things like that. You can also reach out to me for like one-on-one coaching. I also do the Successory Show podcast with Trevor.
That's where I cheat on Tony.
Yeah.
About other podcasts around here.
So that's on basically every major streaming platform. I do also do the social media for Subject Zero. So things I get posted there, it's me. So I'm mostly the one talking to people. I know like me, Tony, and Kaylee are all on it talking to everyone, but like the posting there. And I think that's it. I think that's everything that I do at the moment. Schedule. I think that's everything that I do at the moment.
Nice. So make sure to go and check her stuff out, support her, buy her shirts, follow her on Instagram, ask her questions when she posts Q&A, all that fun stuff. Trevor, Nobody really cares what you have to say.
I don't even care. I may or may not have worn the habitual strength t-shirt when I pulled 815 twice.
Yeah, so I'm not saying that like you'll PR on it, like you'll PR in it.
It's pretty much
like,
guaranteed. I'm
guaranteed
saying,
yeah. Improve your deadlift by 800%.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
There's studies.
Yes, N equals one, for sure.
Every time.
Yeah, check out Trevor's Instagram. He has seminars coming up with Greg Panora. They have a bunch lined up. I've seen a handful of them that I can't name off the top of my head, and I don't know the dates, so I can't promote them. But if you have that stuff, do you have a website that actually has your shit on it yet?
I sort of.
Jesus Christ.
So I got a guy doing a lot, but I don't have the schedule on there. Riley writes down when these things are booked.
So I can tell you.
Yeah. So I have okay. November 7th in Surge to New Levels in Illinois will be the first seminar that Greg and I do. Tony and I have the Coach's Corner seminar. We've got to get rescheduled for Rockwell Barbell that will be in Chicago, hopefully at some point next year. They'll have us up there. We'll have one in the Pacific Northwest, you and I, at Tasha's gym, I believe, right?
Yeah, that's the plan, yeah.
That's the plan, so hopefully that comes out next year. And then there's another one in the Northeast somewhere. Greg and I are confirmed for Surge to New Levels, and I believe we're also confirmed for Smash Fitness in December in Vegas, I think.
Nice.
There's also one in February and one in March.
Yeah, February is Missouri. I'm drawing a blank on the name at the moment. It might be
Ironworks.
Something Ironworks Open Gym 24, something like that.
Yeah, one of them is Ironworks, One of them's in Missouri, and the second one is in Michigan.
Michigan. So I'm gonna be cold.
Yeah, that doesn't sound fun at all.
I was trying to get all the seminars between you and I and everything in the summer months when it wasn't cold, right? And COVID screwed that all up.
Yeah, I know, fucking COVID. So yeah, check those out. Also support the company that support us: Subject Zero Supplements, Ritual Apparel, Metrolife, Renaissance Periodization, and Iron Rebel. Mm-hmm. Got them all? Yeah, nailed it.
Yep.
Perfect. Nice. Yeah, thanks for listening. Yeah. If you guys like the episode, please go to the iTunes and leave a review and a 5-star rating. And we appreciate all the questions as always. And thanks for listening, guys. And we'll catch you next week.
It's been a day for me. Yeah. Hey, I remember syrup sandwiches and crumb allowances. Vanessa Nickel.